This is the calling of the disciples. Just as an up-to-date, if you haven't been worshiping with us, we've been doing a series on Jesus' miracles. And miracles in God's Word are performed by God, obviously, through creation and many other things. Sometimes he delegates his authority to men, like Elijah and Moses, where they seem to do miracles, but that's just the power of God going through them as an instrument of God. So sometimes God delegates his authority. And recorded in Scripture are different types of miracles. For example, Jesus healed people. He raised people from the dead. He had miracles over creation. And he cast out demons. Those are the major categories of miracles that he performed. And we've looked at Jesus turning water into wine. And we have studied Jesus walking on water. And I don't know if you've identified the theme that we're working with here, but these are the miracles of Jesus over creation. Now, we're not taking God's Word in chronological order because God's Word doesn't go in chronological order. You get the different Gospels, and they're grouped according to theme because God wants us to understand what he's saying, not get it all ordered in our head. How many of you have ever read the Rewrite Bible, the chronological Bible? Anybody delve into that one? A few of you? The chronological Bible. Now, what happens is we have this mind that we want to put everything in the order that we want it so that we get it, so that we understand it. And so if people take God's Word, we'll put it in a chronological order so that we can make sense of it the way that we want to make sense of it. And I want to share with you today that God's Word doesn't do that. What God's Word does, it puts it in a certain frame so that a certain lesson can be impacted on us and on our hearts, not so that we can figure out everything that we want to figure out. And so Luke handles things a little bit differently than Matthew. And so what we're going to look at today is the multiplication of the fish. How many of you are familiar with the story, the calling of the first disciples? Okay, bunch of fish. Now, following our theme, we're looking at Jesus' miracles over creation. The category is oftentimes, if you want to look it up and read about it on the internet, they call it miracles of nature, or miracles over nature. Now, I just want to use this as an example, how sometimes we take things in the world mindset, and we just cram them into God's Word, and it changes the way we think about things. The word nature itself is framed on a philosophy of naturalism, not supernaturalism. If you watch the Nature Channel, does it tell you anything about God? No. It's all framed on Darwin's theory of how things evolve naturally. Origin of the species through natural processes, not supernatural. So when Jesus does these miracles, he's doing these miracles not over nature, over supernature. He's doing these things because he's the creator himself, and he's demonstrating his power over them. So I would just encourage you to continue to formulate the Christian worldview that is oftentimes lost, even if we're looking at the beauty of creation. We take a walk and we say, I'm taking a nature walk. No, you're not taking a nature walk. You're taking a supernature walk because you're walking in God's creation. You're not going to hear God's voice if you give credit to someone that's not there. So change your mind to see what Jesus is doing in his creation. He's the Lord of the fishes. In Genesis, when God created all the creatures that teemed in the waters, he did it by his word. He didn't observe something that was naturally in order. It was his own order when he was on this fishing boat. So keeping that in mind, let's read what God's word says. One day as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, or Sea of Galilee, with the people crowding around him and listening to the word of God, he saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. Let's pause there for a moment. When we were in the Boundary Waters this last week, one of the things that we frequently heard were voices of other people as they're amplified across the water. And there are some days where I felt sorry for other campers because they have giggling girls in certain camps, which you already heard about. So Jesus used the amphitheater that was there to teach the people, and they all heard him clearly. Verse 4, when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into deep water and let down the nets for a catch. Simon answered, Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. And because you say so, I will let down the nets. Sometimes God asks us to do things that we don't want to do. You ever have that happen? You work hard, you're tired, you're weary, and then God says, this is what I want you to do. And we have a choice at that point to say, no, I'm tired. I've been doing my thing for a while, and I really don't feel up to doing your thing right now. How many of you ever struggled with the talking pillow on a Sunday morning? The one that says, stay here. You are so tired. You know, you get to get the McDonald's theme song, you deserve a break today. And, you know, it's like, oh, I need rest more than I need a sermon. I've heard that before. Now, Jesus oftentimes calls us to do something beyond what we would normally do. And so, wisely, he says, we've been at it, we're weary, we've been up all night, but because you say so, we're going to do it. There's a message there for us. Because you say so, we're going to do it. This speaks to obedience. Being obedient when you don't feel like it is the call of every disciple of Jesus. Okay, so let's get on with the story. When they had done so, they caught such a large number of fish that the nets began to break. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and to help them. And they came and filled both boats so full that they began to sink. Any fishermen ever fill their boat so full that they began to sink? Now, the response when you see something like this, fish boiling in the water into the nets to such a degree that they are breaking, causes a certain kind of response. And that response is given by Simon Peter, when he fell at Jesus' knees and said, go away from me, Lord, I am a sinful man. He was confronted with the God who, with words, had fish teem in the original creation. Now, when the fall happened, when sin entered the world, things no longer teemed like that. After sin enters the world, what you have is scarcity. When you work, your labor isn't easy. You just don't go out and pick fruit and not labor for it. Part of the fall affected creation as well. And things don't happen like that. Many times you go out fishing and you work and work and work at it and you come up with nothing. Isn't that right, Lewis? Can I hear an amen to that? He's saying he was hoping to get that $40 worth out of his license, and he got a great big goose egg. Any fisherman knows what this story goes like. But he was face to face with God, who was Lord of the fishes, and he knew it. And often, if you look at the miracles, God multiplies. He multiplies the bread. He multiplies the wine. He multiplies the fish. See, God is a God who gives multiplication. I'll tell you one little other funny story when we were out there. And this kind of is like that. Sometimes things happen in life that kind of crack you up, and then later you find a lesson in it. On Saturday, we celebrated Skylar's birthday, which is kind of fun. And we got a Dairy Queen cake. And then Noah said something to Skylar. What did you say, Noah? He said, thank you for being born, Skylar. And then what did Joel say? What did you say, Joel?
I said, you should be thanking me.
Yeah. And interestingly enough, there's a lesson in this too, because sometimes we take credit where God did that. I mean, it wasn't Joel that created this beautiful young woman. Right? Amen? Who of us, if we, anybody ever try to have a child and not succeed? What can we control? We can go fishing, but we can't control the mind of the fish. It's our Creator that does these wondrous things. So we need to give credit where credit is due, like Peter did. He fell at his feet and worshipped him. And the companions were so astonished at the catch of the fish that they had taken, verse 10, and so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will catch men." Now, when we see and come face to face with the awesome presence of God, there's fear there. Why? Because we are sinful. We come into the presence of a holy God and we recognize before His holiness that we are sinful people. And woe to the person who doesn't recognize their sin before a holy God. And He assured him, "Do not be afraid." When you know the love of Jesus for us, you no longer have to be afraid. And He says, "I'm going to make something of you, Peter. I am going to make you something." Now, Peter, likely his dad, like James and John, were made fishermen by his father. And their chosen profession, God was going to make them into something different. Now, there are many of us who want to be self-made. We want to do what we're going to do. We're going to go out there and do it. We're going to get in that canoe and we're going to paddle out of here. And we forget to ask God to help us. And then we take this turn and that turn. And the wind comes up against you. And you get to a certain point when you realize, well, maybe we need God's help. And then God directs your path. Don't be afraid. I've talked to a lot of people who are afraid of what God's going to do with them. One of the big things that they're afraid of is they're afraid they're going to lose out on their fun. They're not going to be able to do the stuff that they used to do. Well, you can still choose to do that stuff. But people that take the path away from God to live, they call it living free, find out that it's living in bondage. They chase after things that they can never get. And they get on a treadmill of life that has no blessing. And God can make us into something if we say yes to follow Him. Life without Christ is empty now. You try to get out there and do it on your own. Talk to people who make those choices and say, "I want to live the way that I want to live." And ask them how that turns out. How does that come out in the end? And Jesus basically said, "So, don't be afraid. From now on, you will catch men." So they pulled their boats up on shore, left everything, and followed Him. Following Christ requires leaving something behind. To James and John, it meant leaving Zebedee and Sons Fishing Company. In my mind, as I see them fishing in the boat, I can see Zebedee and Sons written on the back of the boat. And their dad sitting there with all the stuff. We know from the account of the book of Matthew that that's exactly what the case was. They were fishing with their dad. And when they left their dad in the boat. They walked away from him. Some of the things that we hold on to in this world are hard to let go. Amen? We say, "I'll give God this easy thing." But the hard stuff we want to keep to ourselves. Many times we see time as ours. How am I going to spend my time? Well, whose time is it? Who created it? It's God's time. And yet we claim it to our own to manage our own time. Well, what happens if we give God that which is already His? And we see it as His time. Well, then, oftentimes we spend it with Him. And we listen to him. Like the disciples in this particular occasion when he said in their presence, "Do not be afraid. I will make you fishers of men." And the Matthew account says, "Follow me." Same here. But the words are repeated often. Follow him and he will make you fishers of men. Anyone know the song that you sang when you were kids? How's it go? "Make you fishers of men, fishers of men, fishers of men. I will make you fishers of men if you follow me." And then the chorus, if you follow me, right? If. That's a big if. Who's going to make you a fisher of men? Jesus is. You're not. You're not going to do it. He's going to do it. Now, we're told in the scriptures that God is the potter and we are the clay. How does God make you into something if you're not teachable? How does God make you into something if you're not obedient? People in the Old Testament were talked about many, many times because they were stubborn. They were hard clay. Now, what did God do to hard clay? Anybody ever have to go to the College of Hard Knocks to learn what God wanted to say to them? That's what he's doing. Newsflash. Sometimes we have to go through the difficult time to get the lessons that God wants us to get because we're too closed-minded to get them in the peace, in the quiet, in the calm. So, the God who has created the heavens and the earth now is in the presence of these men and saying, "Now, if you want to accomplish something, you follow me. And I'll make you into something completely different." Now, I want to ask you a very serious question. What would these men have accomplished in life if they said no that day? What would be left behind? A pile of fish. They'd made some meals. They would have made some money. They would have had a decent career, put food on the table for their kids. Period. They'd have blown the opportunity to become what Jesus called them to be, fishers of men. Now, the same question is put to us. Will we follow him and allow him to make us fishers of men? Now, I want to summarize the lessons from this text. One, Jesus is the Lord over all creation. It's his. He made it. He's the one that answered the prayer of sending the northern lights. That Tess prayed before we went on the trip. God helped me to see the northern lights and the best northern lights in 20 years, the outfitter told us afterwards. That's cool. God orchestrating the timing of the thunder and lightning with their camp over there. They're praying to God while they're doing it and directing the, it's like, "Wait, there right now." It's like, now God did it. You know, God didn't make them like Harry Potter or something. But God revealed his glory. Pretty awesome. God's in charge. God's in control. By the way, whose earth is this anyway? This is God's. If we get in our mind that the fish are ours and not God's, we come up with all these management plans from the DNR trying to manage the fish population. Man, I've lived in several states, Iowa, South Dakota, Wisconsin, and Michigan. And you want to hear an oxymoron, it's game management. Management? Really? You know, you think you start to manage something, and then, you know, you're going to manage the forest, and then the ashbourne. And you're going to manage the seas, and then you introduce all these different species. We don't do a very good job managing stuff down here, because we have such little control. And we think we can manage the weather. Now, last week before we went to the Boundary Waters, we looked at the weather report, and we were supposed to have rain and nastiness every day. We had awesome weather. We had a thunderstorm that I prayed for. We had some some challenges, but for the most part, it was gorgeous. Why? Because God is the God of the weather, not the weather man. Can I hear an amen to that? Insurance companies believe in God, even though they don't often claim to. Because people will work all their lives to accumulate something, and then an event happens, sweeps it all away in a day, and then what do they call that? They call that an act of God. That's because we're not bigger. God can take away everything we work for our entire life in a single moment. Everything that we think that we're piling up down here is only a moment away. One of the things fishermen love to do, and I admit, did it in the Boundary Waters, after catching a mess of fish, right? I've got so many dumb pictures like that. Yeah. Now, and maybe, you know, they didn't have a camera back then, but I'm sure they come in after a big catch, which happens infrequently. And it's like, come check this out. Look what I caught today. Right? Trophies. Owls. I want to ask you a very specific question. What happens to all those pictures? They end up in a landfill long after you're dead. That's what happens to them. They fade. One or two might be cherished, not because of the fish in it, because somebody loves you. But after time, it's all gone. But you become a fisher of men. You invest in people. You make disciples. Like Jesus taught his. Go therefore and make disciples like he had made them. You join God in his work and you join into his eternal power. And God makes a difference in the world through you. Now, would you settle just for work? Or would you rather join in God's work? That's really the question. It's delegated authority. The disciples did some pretty incredible things, as the Lord can do through you. The Lord incredibly brought about children from us. Now, Skyler just didn't happen. God, according to Psalm 139, was there when she was knit together in her mother's womb. He was there when she was created in the secret place. He knows every word that is formed on her tongue before it even comes to be. He has the number of hairs on her head numbered, which is a far higher number than mine. And we can be a part of what God does, or not. So what about you? What does God want to make out of you? Now, some of us think that God wants to make some kind of career. Well, God does give us a way to provide for our families. But that's not what he wants to make out of you. He wants to make disciples out of you. He wants you to be fisher of men, like he did before. So, are you following Jesus? Are you praying today? Or are you too busy for that because you see your time as yours instead of God's? Are you doing what you want to do? Are you doing what God calls you to do? All of our work will amount to nothing. Life without Christ is an empty net. And we know the opposite. God who made the heavens and the earth is the God who made the oceans and the deep, and the God who made the fish teem in the oceans, and the God who made the fish teem and gathered in the nets. This is the same God that will make you fishers of men, if only you follow him. Thank you. God, you've done many awesome works. We've been witness to many of them in our own lifetime and heard testimony of some of them today. Now we ask that you to do an awesome work in us. Make us fishers of men. Give us willing, obedient hearts that will follow you wherever you call us to go. Give us strength to let go of the things that will keep us from being who you call us to be, so that you would be glorified and worshiped as our Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, we're going to receive the morning offering. And after we do that, we're going to end with How Deep the Father's Love.